man is walking down the street with a Bible in his hand, you wouldn't say, "Here goes a Christian." If a Japanese man passed you by, neither would you say, "Good morning, Buddha." And if an Arab-looking man with a full face of beard approaches you, you wouldn't say, "Here comes Muhammad." So why is it that every dreadlock-sporting person is deemed a Rastafari? Do we truly understand, or as the Rastas would say, overstand, what it truly means to be Rastafari? With modernization has come the revision of Jah laws for the convenience of man, with a mixture of fashion and fakes intermingled with 12 tribes, with Bobos and Nyabingi, who is truly reflective of the authentic liberty of Rastafari.
The Bongo Nati Dread, the red, gold, and green. The music, the undeniable aroma of Sensimania. The reasoning sessions, the Aital food, the praise to Haile Selassie, the hills, the segregation, and the liberty of Rastafari is as much a taboo as it is an open subject.
Now then, Captain, can you give me some idea as to how many blacks your vessel will hold?
170, Mr. Gardner.
The history of Rastafari begins with the colonization of Africa, or Ethiopia, as it is known to believers by the Europeans. Millions of Africans were stolen from their homeland and scattered throughout the Americas and enslaved by the white man. This unfamiliar land shall forever be deemed as Babylon to believers. For the enslaved, this meant suppression of their culture by the white man for generations. They have latched on to the belief that someday they shall return to Mount Zion in Ethiopia.
We will kill, we will win, we will live, we will live.
Rastafari movement began in Jamaica during the 1930s, following a prophecy made by Marcus Garvey, a black political leader. Garvey led an organization known as the Universal Negro Improvement Association, whose intention it was to unite blacks with the land of their origin. Garvey preached, "Look to Africa, where a black king shall be crowned. He shall be your redeemer." This statement became the foundation of the Rastafari movement. This prophecy was rapidly followed by the crowning of Emperor Haile Selassie I in Ethiopia. Rastafarians see this as the fulfillment of Garvey's prophecy. Haile Selassie is regarded by Rastafarians as the black messiah, Jah Rastafari. He is a figure of salvation, and it is believed he will redeem blacks from white suppressors, reuniting them with their homeland, Africa. October 19th, 1937, a large crowd braved the rain to give Marcus Garvey a rousing welcome as he addressed thousands of St. Lucians at Clark Cinema. This further fertilized black consciousness and, by extension, Rastafari's teachings. In 1966, Haile Selassie visited Jamaica, where the reception was, to say the least, astonishing.
Take your troubles to Selassie.
The development of reggae music during this period made Rastafari audible and visible. The lyrical bravery and melodious high from Brother Bob and his Wailers cemented the teachings of Rastafari and was used to spread one love the world over.
Thanks.
There are three separatist movements within Rastafari: the Naya Bingi, 12 Tribes, and Bobo Shanti. The latter was founded in 1958 in Jamaica by Prince Emmanuel Charles Edwards, considered by many to be the Black Christ. Prince Emmanuel, Marcus Garvey, and Haile Selassie are regarded as part of the Holy Trinity. Bobos wear highly colored turbans and long flowing robes. Bobo Shanti women must cover their arms and legs. This group fasts twice a week and on the first day of every month. The Bobo Shanti movement is concerned with fulfilling Marcus Garvey's Back to Africa campaign, reuniting Africans with their homeland, and abandoning contact with Western society. Some Bobo Shantis feel Black people should be compensated for having endured slavery. In the late 60s, Bobo dreads washed up on St. Lucian shores. The reaction was mixed, and for the most part, it was frowned upon. To escape the tribulations of the 70s, many Rastafarians fled to the hills to form communities of their own. What happened next was cemented in the musical wax records of St. Lucia. Music is as much a part of Rastafari as weed and agriculture. Naya Bingi music is used during reasoning sessions and consists of chanting and drumming to reach states of heightened spirituality. One man has spread this infectious music, and with it, the liberty of Rastafari has spread to every continent. The true believers of Rastafari's teachings have been persecuted and prosecuted for their religious beliefs for decades. In the land where it all started, at 18 degrees north, 77 degrees west, animosity involving the wider society and Rastafarians culminated in bloodshed in 1963 when Rastas and civilians clashed. The Jamaica Defense Force was called in and many Rastas were killed and hundreds beaten. St. Lucia has not been kinder to Rastafarians. Their civilization on Mount Jimmy was destroyed. For over 25 years, they were not allowed to attend government schools. Needless to say, that thousands have been prosecuted for possession of ganja. Whoa, push on through. Whoa. Fast forward to 2014, and what passes off as Rastafari is dreadlocks wearing men and women who are far removed from the teachings of His Imperial Majesty. But if you escape the Icars and a dozen tribes and you survive the Food of Seven, you will still have to walk to Pitonflor, a remote, heavily forested area between Foreste and Denry. And trust me, it is a walk. You will come upon one of the last surviving virgin Rastafarian settlements in St. Lucia. When we return, we meet a man with 13 children and a community that exemplifies the liberty of Rastafari. And that's why I've got to get on
. This doesn't happen every day.
Wow.
This doesn't happen every day either. What does happen every day are the amazing low prices on the KFC What a Deal value menu. Try the new KFC Spicy Barbecue Wrap, featuring chicken strips, spicy barbecue sauce, and crispy onions, all wrapped in a toasted tortilla. At KFC, this happens every day. So good.
I'm the cat that is the first all the time, with a bat swinging homers all the time. On the track, I'm the first to cross the line. When I play in Vegas, the cash is all mine.
I know what's up with you. I wanna be down with you. Can I? Can I? Can I? Can I?
The 4G Google Nexus, available at the computer store in the American Drywall Building, Bidwood Side.
Outreach 2014 explodes with excitement with Junior Panorama on March 30th at the Cultural Center Grounds. The National Arts Exhibition at Blue Coral Mall, March 31st to April 5th, will feature over 40 fine artists and craftspeople from around the island. From Monday, April 7th to 13th at the NCC, 5 theme nights showing off the diversity of creative talent in the National Arts Festival. The communities of Anseleray with their traditional music and theater on April 25th and Babylon on April 27th with their Afrocentric rhythms will come alive as these communities become the hotspots of activity. May 3rd, the Artist Market at Rodney Bay will feature a bustling fair of the best of St. Lucia's creative products. Come shop, watch, demonstrate, and try your hands at creating with mini classes. Outreach, colors and contours, rhythm and rhyme.
She keep nagging me about changing this and changing that. Only fool in my head, man.
I said, well, change the thing for her, man.
She want a new kitchen. Something about a sexy front door. She want wooden flooring and LED light throughout the house. Where she feel like getting her money?
She do ask you to put in PVC windows too, man. Hear that, hear that. Renick and Company has great deals on all of them things. You gotta check them out.
Yes, sir. I don't care. Putting my foot down.
Cassa, wasn't about the place you told me about the other day again? Renick and Company? Okay, thanks.
Whether planning to build a house or remodel an old one, you'll be glad to know that Renick and Company has some of the best deals on doors, windows, flooring, classic and modern style kitchens, LED lights, and much more. Renick and Company, shopping the world for you.
Meet the Martyrs. Father, James Red Radix Martyr. Mariana, his lovely wife. Sons, Natty, Dreddy, Taman, Zim, Chezi, and Dibas. And his princesses, Shebla, Afri, Millie, Opian, Majest, Million, and Jawil. They live on this farm in the thick of these hills, along with eight other similarly minded Rastafarians. I started with the two most important questions. What does it mean to be Rastafari? And why live in these hills?
To be a Rasta is the creator Jah Rastafari arise in a man and take him away from the sin. So to be a Rasta man is to be alive. Well, as a youth, I never liked combing my hair. And I used to get even beaten by my father to comb my hair. And my father was a preacher in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And he wanted me to dress like, say, decent. That's how people look at it, decent. But more like a European, you know what I mean? As my shirt have to be in my pants and my hair well combed. But when I was about 7 years, I had a vision. And that vision, I saw a man with a lock was walking up a hill. And I saw another man was putting something in his head. So I asked him, what's that? He told me, if you want to go to heaven, you put that in your head, in the dream I had, the vision. So I ran up to the man that was climbing the mountain, and when I was just about reaching to him with my two hands stretched out for some, then he just took it from the bucket he had and he just put it in my head so. And then when he put it, then I still asked for some more, and he gave me some again. So I took it and I was running to bring it to my brothers and sisters so we could go to heaven. And from that age, my mentality and my spirit is toward the black race.
Your move to paradise, how did that come? When did that come? And why here?
Okay. Well, I was in New York City and doing some research and looking into the history, I see that there's a lot of prophecies that is prophesied on the land, and nothing could stop them from happening. And there'll be famine and desolations, and they will not have food, and the cities will burn. So we then should stop being fooled by European knowledge of God going in the sky and look toward Africa, our homeland, and to return there. And I couldn't stay in the city and return to my roots in the city. I mean, I have to plant food, I have to eat, I like clean water, I like the fresh air, and I cannot get that in the city. I had to let my logs grow to identify who I am, who I represent.
Why here?
Well, in this mountain.
This
piece of land belonged to my wife's grandfather. And I met the grandfather in New York, and I talked to him, and I married to his daughter, and then I told him I wanted to live in the hills. And he told me I could live on his land.
Red Radix has 15 children, 13 with his wife, and 11 of his offsprings were delivered by him right here in these mountains.
We had one born in the city in a hospital, but the ones that I delivered, she said it was better with me than the hospital. And in the hospital, if she had to bear children, I mean, we have a system where they cut in the women, cut in the belly and taking out children, and I don't stand that. I think that no natural woman wants that. They want to bear their children naturally.
What was it like delivering the first child?
First child? It was like having respect for a woman. It was like having respect for your mother, having respect for a woman, seeing the pain a woman go through to bring forth a child. And you don't give up the problem or the trouble to feed the child or take care of the child.
It was good.
How was it having the good doctor here?
Oh, he's fantastic. He's fantastic. He made it easy for me. He made it way lot easy, you know? And I know when a woman is so that she, when especially when she's about to have the child, she feels like helpless. It's like she wants someone to help. And he was there to help me, you know? And I appreciate that of him because I know a lot of men would probably faint or run away or something, you know, but he stayed there and it was good.
The martyrs live on 13 acres surrounded by lush tropical rainforests, hinted to be snake country, with pristine water catchment areas and natural air conditioning 24 hours a day. It's a cool hour's walk to the closest civilization.
How was it when you got here with the children, the small, and you had to plant these fields? What was it like for you as a patriarch?
Coming to the hills with a woman and a son, then I had to, like say, return into my roots. I had to rethink of how we used to grow food before because I raised in the country, I like the country life. So it was not too hard for me to get back to, you know, living. My grandmother lived 120 years in the hills, you know what I mean? So she was always in the hills, you know what I mean? That's where she lived, 120 years. So we raised up in the rivers and the fruits and everything. So I always like country life. Returning with a woman was a different, I never had that before. So returning with the woman and the child, I had to secure a warm place. But it is not just a matter of we returning like any body just do it. It's a matter of you returning as Rastafari.
When I came here to, on this mountain, it was like exciting. It was very exciting.
This is a prayer to you, Father Jah.
Oh, yeah.
When I'm in supplication and I cry, hear the voice of my prayer coming from the son, not the conqueror.
Their oldest son is 28. The youngest child is 7. With a musical background, no electricity, and a dozen plus children to teach and entertain, the solution was unorthodox, but all natural.
Have to be an example for them to follow, or else what will they follow in the hills? So I have to sit there, I have to sing a song that is very easy so they could start singing it, and it have to be something that's right. Like, I see the sunset, I'm still praising Jah Jah. Jah give fire every day, give fire every night, you know. So therefore then, and I teach them to tell Jah, to thank Jah every day. So I have to sing that to them. And then we have no instrument, we have nothing, and I have to take some little tin and everything so, and put down another tin and everything so, and I tell him what I know, he do. So we started so, and they started knocking, so every evening when the sun go down, so I call them, I tell them come and sit and sing again. And when we wake up in the morning, sing and read the Bible to them. And my wife is the teacher that have them, teaching them all day while I in the field. You stay home, teach them. So she have to bear them, teach them, wash, cook, and them kind of thing, which a lot of women don't want to do.
We need positiveness. Now, in order for us to move forward in life, because you're growing up, and you'll have to know that life, with life, while you're living, there will be problems, troubles that you come across with. Now, I teach them from coals and cardboard. That's how I started teaching them A and B. So one day I was there, and it was like, my husband goes to the field, and like, and I'm here, I'm there in the house, and here's Natty. What am I gonna do for Natty? So I decided, well, since I know how to read and write, so I'll teach him the alphabet. And from there, I took the piece of coals, cardboard, and I started writing A, B, B. Up to now, my daughter, she's learning the the speech by Malcolm X. I charge the white man. Yeah, and I think she done, she have it already. I'm proud of them. They really picking up fast.
Have any of them ever been to public school?
Public school? Nah.
Why not?
Okay, let's look at a question. 13 children to feed, bus to pay, uniform to buy, books to buy. How would I have the children and have that again? Can you answer me that? And we know in the system that men that have job, politician, big job, can even afford to feed the two little children they have with them women they have in out there. We heard about that.
Some people would say that disadvantages them. What would you say?
I disadvantage them?
No. Some people would say that keeping them at home keeps them at a disadvantage. What would you say?
I would agree. But I would agree it keeps them, the disadvantage would be from being more system tool. While they was absent in the public school, they was present in the home school. So they was always being taught. They were taught to behave themselves, that they should love their mother and father, brother and sisters, not to go and steal people's things, not to go and take cocaine, not to be gunman. Isn't that good education they get? And right now, they are there. And they have the same hope, the same dream for us to repatriate.
Sweet love, sweet love. Oh, Rasta love is the sweetest love. There ain't no ones that could compare to Rasta love. That's what we need.
Most people would be baffled that your children have not been homeschooled, yet they're technologically savvy, they're computer literate, they all play musical instruments. What would you credit that to?
Their father. He taught them all of that, with the computers and all the technology, like he could have get to bring it for them, to help them further their education.
Life is a cycle, go round and round. Today you up, tomorrow you down.
Oh, my mom taught like history. She taught lots of math because she loved math, I guess. She taught math and science and English. She taught those subjects, but I more had rather to choose a subject of music because that's my thing. Yeah, I love music.
Give a little bit. Show love to the poor. You better give something to the poor. Show love to the poor.
Did you have friends apart from your brothers and sisters growing up?
Oh no, just my brothers and sisters.
Did you think that you were missing out on anything?
No, not really. I don't know.
Some people will say that you live up here segregated from everybody else, yet you are technologically savvy, and that's not liberty of Rastafari. What would you say?
Oh, Rastafarianism is like following the Bible, following what is written. We are not against education as Rastafarian people. People will look at us and say that we are savages because we are living up in this and we didn't go to a public school. But it is, like Marcus Garvey said, we can educate ourselves outside of the classroom. We doesn't have to go inside of a building to be educated. We can be educated outside of the classroom also and even attain a higher education or higher level of education than even them that was sitting in the classroom. So it is not like We never go to a public school, so it's like we're not educated to that form.
So we see there's a lamb standing on Mount Zion, and then with 144,000, and they having the father name written on the forehead. So what John saw was 144 dreadlocks, Rastaman.
What challenges have you faced by the local authorities as it relates to your decision to live in the hills, and also to homeschool your children?
They come and they talk to my children, and then they even find that my children was in the right place from all the crime and the violence that's going on. And they find the children was intelligent, and then after they left, then Dr. Rambali came here to check the children, and Dr. Rambali said that they was healthy. He also asked about the delivery, how I delivered them, I told him, and he asked the same question you asked. If something happened to them, what will I do? I gave him the same answer, that I would seek medical attention or something, because it's not that I don't want my children, you know, I'm not on the, say, segregating from this, from that. From the evil, from the poison, from the pollution, it's good for us to separate ourselves from that.
Walk the proud land, my friends. Walk the proud land, my friends.
When we return, we meet the rest of the Rastafari community on the hill. And also, do these parents allow their children to smoke marijuana?
Everybody should smoke marijuana. Don't you think that everyone should smoke marijuana?
Shiki,
keep nagging me about changing this and changing that. Only fool in my head, man.
I thought we'd change the thing for her, man.
She wants a new kitchen. Something about a sexy front door. She wants wooden flooring and LED light throughout the house. Where's she gonna get that money?
She do ask you to put in PVC windows too, man. Tell you that, hear that. Renick and Company has great deals and all of them things. Check them out.
Yes, sir. I don't care. Putting my foot down.
Kasa, wasn't it about the place you told me about the other day again? Renick and Company? Okay, thanks.
Whether planning to build a house or remodel an old one, you'll be glad to know that Renick and Company has some of the best deals on doors, windows, flooring, classic and modern style kitchens, LED lights, and much more. Renick and Company, shopping the world for you.
Tanya has always been a little delayed. Okay, maybe very delayed. Tanya needed to do something that will help her keep up. So she took the first step to rev up her life and signed up for Lime 4G. In the world of 4G, Tanya could download songs in seconds, movies in minutes, and watch all her smart devices come to life with lightning fast speed. Don't miss your moment. Sign up for the first 4G experience to hit St. Lucia. Smart, fast, imagine. Lime, value every moment.
Outreach 2014 explodes with excitement with Junior Panorama on March 30th at the Cultural Center Ground. The National Arts Exhibition at Blue Coral Mall, March 31st to April 5th, will feature over 40 fine artists and craftspeople from around the island. From Monday, April 7th to 13th at the NCC, five theme nights showing off the diversity of creative talent in the National Arts Festival. The communities of Anseleray with their traditional music and theater on April 25th and Babylon on April 27th with their Afrocentric rhythms will come alive as these communities become the hotspots of activity. May 3rd, the Artist Market at Rodney Bay will feature a bustling fair of the best of St. Lucia's creative products. Come shop, watch, demonstrate, and try your hands at creating with mini classes. Outreach, colors and contours, rhythm and rhyme.
And is the first all the time, with a bat swinging homers all the time. On the track, I'm the first to cross the line. When I play in Vegas, the cash is all mine.
I wanna know what's up with you. I wanna be down with you. Can I? Can I? Can I? Can I?
The new Kindle Fire HDX, available at the computer store in the American Drywall Building, Vidbute.
Blue Water's posse identified!
Somebody pass blue water! Somebody bring blue water! Somebody get blue water! And be ready now!
When you're feeling hard,
take a blue water spray!
Distributed by Blue Water St. Lucia Limited.
Cha! Rastafari! Lassie!
Strangest feeling I'm feeling. But your love we will always believe in. Though you may think my fate is in vain, till Shiloh we chant Rastafari's name.
Perched high in the mountains between Forestay and Denry is a community of 23 people, ranging from 7 to 65 years. They have escaped the city and modern civilization to live according to Jah laws. James Red Radix Martyr is the patriarch. His wife Mariana cares for their 13 children. Erica Brown and Chad Hananiah are community members
who subscribe to the teachings and have been welcomed into the fold.
Tell me about life on the hill, Erica Brown.
My dream come true. Yes, my dream come true. It's a life I wanted to live because I was a city girl and I was tired of the city and I wanted to live in the hills. It gives me the power to stop the dirty habits I used to had. It gives me that peace of mind also to focus on what life is really about.
Some people would see your family on television and say, these people are weird. They choose to be up here with no television, no running water. To do what? What would you say?
Well, that's how they see it. Because to them, without those things, the water and the TV and the nightlife, to them, it's boring. That's an entertaining life, and to live this life is like boring. But when you know for what cause, then to you it's not boring. It was to get to know yourself and your Creator. So then if that's the important mission, it's not boring to you at all. I do farming, I plant vegetables, foods, you know. I go to the city and I sell my stuff. I sell natural stuff for people to cleanse their body, like the old-time tradition, you know.
Erica Brown and her mother, Martha Brown, have lived in these hills for more than 16 years. Using oral traditions passed down through generations, they prepare herbal medicines meant to rejuvenate the body. Chad has only been in these hills for a few months, but has found his calling.
To live in the mountains, to live among good people, to live where people respect you, to live where Jah asks us to live for his great plan for us in the future. That's why I love to live here. We farm together. We work as one, as a unit. We farm everything we can get that is good to farm to eat. I came and met it here happening long before me. So my little input is more help and to do and learn. Jah choose a people to live like that. And we have to be the people we bear in the cross. So then we have to be ostracized because we have to fulfill the word.
The Book of Revelation spoke of the last days. Movies have been produced depicting certain destruction.
You're seeing live footage of a tsunami engulfing the port area of Kamai City in Iwate Prefecture.
Mother Nature has given us a taste of what is to come. Creatures of every denomination have foretold of the apocalypse, and even our present shepherd has predicted it.
Experts at the University of the West Indies and experts elsewhere in North America and Europe have been predicting that a major earthquake will probably strike the Caribbean.
The Mata family has taken the high ground for the last 28 years and can easily be described as St. Lucia's premier doomsday preppers.
Marcus Garvey tell us to live 10 miles from the city, from corruption. But we see there is a prophecy that even Marcus saw. Marcus see in the last days, things would be so rough and drastic. So it's to the hills they'll run from tsunami, from riots, from whatever that come. They'll run to the hills. But let's look at St. Lucia. And if a tsunami had to hit St. Lucia right now, or a big quake, and it throw down the communication system, the bridges, the dams, the what St. Lucia government have to feed the nation? Where warehouse they have to feed the nation? And for how long? Because a massive quake or tsunami can wipe out the Caribbean. And they are scientists saying they're expecting it from the east and it's overdue. And what do they have there in place? And if the people have to run in the hills, if you have to run in the hills, what will you go and eat? Mahogany? Blue Maho? What do they have? So if we then look at, when we see that then, when they reject Rasta, when they run, when the tsunami comes, they'll find Rasta on top of the mountain with a handful of corn.
Many Rastas limit their diet to what they consider pure food. Additives such as artificial flavoring and preservatives are avoided. Alcohol, coffee, and cigarettes are shunned as tools of Babylon that pollute and consume. Many Rastas are vegetarians, although some eat certain kinds of fish. This family grows bananas, dashin, yam, and the sweetest pineapple in St. Lucia. Cabbages and tomatoes are plentiful here, and it is all free of chemicals.
We just plan to eat. When it comes, if we have to sell, then we can sell. But right now we're planning to eat. And I think that's what everyone should do, every family should do, should look towards planting. Because in the time that's coming, or even right now, look how hard it is, how things are going up, prices, you know, it's getting tougher. So when I look at it, is plan for yourself to eat, and at least you could try and plant a little bit more to give someone else.
I man take a look in the world today. I see the poor people working hard every day. They don't have no time to sit around and play. I see them on their feet hustling every day. We have to keep working just to make a living, not robbing and killing or stealing people things. We have to do what it takes to get it honestly, and or sell drugs and cooking just to get money. By the sweat of your brow you shall eat bread, and if you survive you shall surely dead. Let the sick be nourished and the hungry be fed. Let the infants be cared and the blind be led.
So strongly do the martyrs believe in Rasta liberty, agriculture and music, that their band, the Intelligent Youths, have married them all in a true musical Ital blend.
Reggae music is my culture. Reggae music and agriculture. Reggae music, roots and culture. And I must give thanks and praise unto Jaja. Reggae music is my culture. Reggae music and agriculture. Reggae music, roots and culture. And I will never follow the ways of Lucifer.
The use of ganja is justified by Rastafarians on the basis that it is a plant which grows from the earth and was therefore given to man. Many biblical quotes are employed, including Genesis chapter 1, verse 29. Behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth, in which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed. To you it shall be for meat. The book of Revelations chapter 22 verse 2. In the midst of the street, there was the tree of life, and the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nation. Rastas believe ganja to be this tree, and the smoking of it to be in accordance with the natural way.
There are many people who will watch that program and think, this guy is living up in the hills because he wants to grow marijuana and take advantage of it without people interfering with him. What would you say?
Many has tried, you know, many tried to just go and live in the hills and just grow weed, you know what I mean? And it didn't work. Because Selassie I don't say he'll just send you in the hill and plant weed. Selassie I say, when you bethink him, when you remember Africa, when you turn yourself from evil, from wicked and iniquity, when you stop sinning, and some people that don't know what sin is, they have a Bible to go and see what sin is. So when they stop those things, then he said, born again. He said, separate yourself. It said, flee into the mountain. And then we see a man that come to live as Christ on this earth. When Christ get baptized, when he not up, He went into the mountain. So when a man not up, he leave the system, and then he go into the mountain to pray and fast and to find himself.
Do you discourage your children from partaking in the herb?
Discourage them? Why should I do that? It's the first question I would ask, but I would make a reference. The Bible said, and every Christian knows the Bible say, thou shalt not touch swine or eat swine. And they see there is the family, whether they call themselves the non-Christians, and they have children. And bacon and egg is something they give their children, swine. And will they discourage the children, do not eat bacon? No. Why should I discourage mine from taking the medicine?
Most parents in the general population would discourage their children from smoking marijuana. Would you, considering your Rastafari beliefs?
Marijuana, smoking marijuana is everybody should smoke marijuana. Don't you think that everyone should smoke marijuana? I feel that everyone should smoke marijuana because marijuana is not a drug. It is a herb that God made. The whole Christians know it. Everyone know it. If you read the Bible, you know that that is good because it's God that make it. It have seeds. I don't feel that every mother should like having their children smoking marijuana here, because that's not how we use marijuana. We don't use marijuana like that. But I feel that they should let all their children drink marijuana tea. You see, a lot of people look at marijuana smoking and making you go crazy. But if they take it and they drink it, it is a medicine.
Is there a minimum age for any of your children to partake?
No, there's no minimum age. Because, you know, since I believe that the herb is good, then even when I'm pregnant, what do? I smoke, I drink the tea. It's good. And then to know that I had 13 children and I had no complications, and I was taking marijuana, I was drinking marijuana, and I was smoking marijuana. Because it is there. Marijuana was there before they put that law that is illegal. So I go way back there. Not because they tell me it's illegal that I have to have that mindset that if I drink it or if I smoke it, it's going to do me something bad. It did me something good.
I think that Prime Minister Kenny Anthony should hurry up and legalize that. You understand me? And the Prime Minister of St. Vincent is also asking him to do that. You understand? So it's on the table right now. I think he must be right now there. And then he now supposed to come to the realization. Don't let America heal its sick people with the weed while yours is still dying.
Heart is full of loving for you. No one can take it. No one can steal it. I have a lot of feelings for you.
When we return, a firstborn's quest for his empress, and later, She Black and Afri Martyr tell us all about weed and repatriation.
Wherever you is, wherever you go, I'm attracted to you.
She keep nagging me about changing this and changing that. Only fool in my head, man.
I will change a thing for her, man.
She want a new kitchen. Something about a sexy front door. She want wooden flooring and LED light throughout the house. Where she gonna get that money?
She do ask you to put in PVC windows too, man. Hear that. Renick and Company has great deals on all of them things.
Check them out. Yes, sir. I don't care. Putting my foot down.
Sir, wasn't about the place you told me about the other day again? Renick and Company? Okay.
Whether planning to build a house or remodel an old one, you'll be glad to know that Renikin Company has some of the best deals on doors, windows, flooring, classic and modern style kitchens, LED lights, and much more. Renikin Company, shopping the world for you.
Outreach 2014 explodes with excitement with Junior Panorama on March 30th at the Cultural Center Ground. The National Arts Exhibition at Blue Coral Mall, March 31st to April 5th, will feature over 40 fine artists and craftspeople from around the island. From Monday, April 7th to 13th at the NCC, five theme nights showing off the diversity of creative talent in the National Arts Festival. The communities of Anslaray with their traditional music and theater on April 25th and Babono on April 27th with their Afrocentric rhythms will come alive as these communities become the hotspots of activity. May 3rd, the Artist Market at Rodney Bay will feature a bustling fair of the best of St. Lucia's creative products. Come shop, watch, demonstrate, and try your hands at creating with mini classes. Outreach, colors and contours, rhythm and rhyme.
This doesn't happen every day.
Wow.
This doesn't happen every day either. What does happen every day are the amazing low prices on the KFC What a Deal value menu. Try the new KFC Spicy Barbecue Wrap, featuring chicken strips, spicy barbecue sauce, and crispy onions, all wrapped in a toasted tortilla. At KFC, this happens every day. So good.
Tanya has always been a little delayed. Okay, maybe very delayed. Tanya needed to do something that will help her keep up. So she took the first step to rev up her life and signed up for Lime 4G. In the world of 4G, Tanya could download songs in seconds, movies in minutes, and watch all her smart devices come to life with lightning fast speed. Don't miss your moment. Sign up for the first 4G experience to hit St. Lucia. Smart, fast, imagine. Lime, value every moment.
I am the champ. I'm the captain, is the first all the time. With a bat swinging homers all the time. On the track, I'm the first to cross the line. When I play in Vegas, the cash is all mine.
I wanna know what's up with you. I wanna be down with you. Can I? Can I? Can I? Can I?
The 4G Google Nexus, available at the computer store in the American Drywall Building, Bidwood's Edge.
Blue Water's posse identified!
Somebody pass blue water! Somebody bring blue water! Somebody get blue water! And we ready now!
When you're feeling hot,
take a blue water spray!
Distributed by Blue Waters St. Lucia Limited.
Special request to all DJs and all selectors, and let them know this inspiration come from Natty Conqueror, because me versatile. Me play the reggae music all the while.
His stage name is Natty Conqueror. His voice is destined for international recording studios. His no-nonsense, straight-talking demeanor, mixed with his superior lyrical delivery, would make an excellent mixture of art and business. But Babylon may never know his true potential.
Cause in a Babylon, holy, but things getting worse. And each and every day, another one by the host. But who would judge a blessing? Me say no man can curse. That's what me tell the people every time me rehearse. Because me verse is me play the reggae music all the while.
Now, for some people who will watch the program will say, why is this 28-year-old man living at home with his parents on a hill and not being part and parcel of the further development of society, what would you say?
Well, I would say to like the people who watching this interview or this program, it is a life, a liberty that a lot of parents out there don't have. Like, I give my father all the credit. He's the one that bring me into the music, into agriculture, into the liberty of Rastafari. And I respect and honor him for that. Because I know there's a lot of parents out there, a lot of fathers out there that don't really consider their children and their children's future. You understand? So, with the society business, I haven't worked for people out there. I am my own boss.
The Bible says there will come a time when every man will flee from his parents and find his old mate, and they shall become one. Mm-hmm. Are you at all concerned that your productive years, in your productive years, you haven't found that person?
Not as yet. Not as yet. In this time we're living in there, right now, where can you find a good woman? Where can you find a woman that is faithful and true to a handsome gentleman like me? Because there's a lot of females out there, majority of ladies, young ladies, they don't have a direction. They don't have a mindset to be a good woman on this earth. And it's not easy to find a good woman in this time. Majority of the women out there, they corrupt. They want to be wild. They don't have manners, they don't have respect, not even discipline for their own self, much less for a gentleman.
Do you think that being a Rastafari makes it a bit harder to find that suitable mate? And also being accepted by her family, especially if she's not of the same religious belief?
Well, to tell you, a lot of people think Rasta life is very hard. And the amount of things that they hear about Rasta already, that corrupt their mind. I, as a young Rastafarian, to look for a woman right now, I will first convert her to Rastafari. I will tell her to do what's right. I'll introduce the Bible to her. I will tell her that's how a woman should live, and that's how a man should live. But a lot of the people there nowadays, like, they just put locks in their head for style. So it's very hard to find a positive Rasta.
Rastafari women are known as queens. Their main role is to look after their king. Women are regarded as housekeepers and childbearers. They cannot be called to Rastafari except through their husband. They must not cook for their husband when menstruating. Makeup, promiscuous clothing, and use of chemicals in their hair is a no-no. And certainly, birth control is out of the question. It is regarded as a European tactic to suppress the development of the African population. Women must cover their hair in keeping with the biblical teachings of 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 15. And any woman who prays or proclaims God's message in public worship with nothing on her head disgraces her husband.
If I have to look for a woman right now, I want to be sure that she knows the Bible, and she's serious, and she put on her locks on her head, and she follow everything in the Bible. for she to submit herself to her husband as unto the Lord, and for she to live upright the way a woman's supposed to live, not ruling over the man or feel as if is she that in power. Because in this way we're living in, where we see that the society give women more power over the men. They say ladies first and gentlemen. So they'll put the ladies on top. But if you check it out way back from creation, Adam was first form, then Eve. And out of man, God created woman. So between a man and a woman supposed to understand that a man is the biggest role in her life, because man is Lord of creation, and there's a lot of female women out there. They don't get that in their head yet.
Afri and She Black Marta are 20 and 21 years old. They have lived on this remote hill all their lives. They have never been to public school.
When evening comes and there is no electricity or mainstream lighting, how does that make you feel?
Oh, it feels great, very peaceful. You hear the creatures at night, you enjoy the moonlight.
Yeah, you get to communicate with yourself more, because having the electricity, the TV, and these things take your mind away from studying yourself. But by not having them things, you get a good opportunity to study yourself. Well, we are musicians, always playing music. And apart from music, I love being in the kitchen. Always love cooking food, and well, we do different things like making clothes for ourselves, doing knitting, crocheting, certain things that will keep us occupied instead of just wasting time. I don't like the city, truly.
What about you?
To me, going to the city is like leaving paradise and going to hell. Because it's like so much exhaust in the city, so much, you cannot breathe fresh, eh? You kind of get clean water to drink. Like, when I go in the city, I would be thirsty the whole day because I don't drink the chlorine water. We carry a little water on our waist sometimes to get warm. We kind of drink it and things. So when I come in back in the East, it's like a refreshment. I feel like I'm coming back to paradise.
Do you have friends apart from your brothers and sisters?
No. I would say no. Like, no. Well, we relate to people, we talk to people, but to say real good friends, our other Rastafari brothers and sisters out there, they is part of our family, our friends. So
we have no friends, just our family, my mother, my father, brothers and sisters.
First of all, we would like to have Idrin and Sisdrin. Having a friend is in.
Do you smoke marijuana?
Yes.
Tell me about that.
Well, when I smoke marijuana, it opens up my mind. It makes me think to do righteous things.
Yes, marijuana is good. As long as it is represented to me, I will take it. I love it 100%.
The law says smoking marijuana is illegal. Possessing marijuana is illegal. What's your take?
The law says that. Babylon law says that. But when we have to go according to the law of God, he said every herb healing seed is good for the service of man. And you cannot come and tell me I can eat mangoes, I can eat orange, I can eat celery, but I cannot smoke marijuana. Marijuana is just another plant. So to me, it's not illegal to me.
At what age did you start?
For my mother's womb?
Well.
At what age did you start taking marijuana?
From our mother's
womb. Mother's
womb.
Well, it starts from a very early age. Like,
from time we know
from
ourselves.
From time I know myself smoking.
So, we don't abuse it. We don't just go on smoking the whole day. We use it as a sacrament. Because as Rastas, it is a sacrament to the Rastas. Marijuana don't make you go crazy. They say marijuana make you go crazy, but marijuana don't make you go crazy. Marijuana bring you to your self-consciousness of things that you do back in your past. It reveals them unto you. When you take cocaine, when you take rum, when you take crack and mix all that with, and you're smoking marijuana again. They just want to blame it on the marijuana because the Rastas use it. Like, they want to do everything to fight on the Rastas. So since they know that it's Rasta sacrament, then they will just say it's the marijuana.
Yes, marijuana is good, and I advise to everyone is they should use it in the right way. Like my father said a while ago, don't mix it with anything. And it's the healing of the nation. So however you take it and you use it, you will be healed.
Where do you see yourself 10 years from now?
In the promised land, Africa. That's where we want to be. And all our life we've been waiting to be there. And I just see a future for myself down in Babylon. So hopefully, another 10 years, I'll be in Mount Zion.
Is that your take as well?
Yes.
There are people who may watch this and think, this is a melodious chorus sung by people with one teacher, with one thinking, and it's staged or rehearsed. What would you say?
Well, no, I would not disagree because children are there to follow after their parents. But when it comes to the levity, there is one right way and many wrong. So if our parents come and live in a right way and we come and live in a right way too, it's not like we'll say following, it is following our parents, but not like to say following our parents, but following a righteous way.
Yes, because even Jah say, train a child in the right way so he will not depart from it when he grow. So as long as you're in training the right way, don't depart. So I cannot depart from that. I could never see myself as a comb hair.
Never.
So I will forever be Rasta.
Forever. No, that's a the dream, way my father, not a thought of being a comb hair. Rasta for life. The next generation of matters by us, Rasta. Whole Rasta family. Rasta father, Rasta mother and children. Living in Africa, because we don't have plans to get married in Babylon or nothing like that. Our future plan is going to Africa. When we reach in Africa, we settle, then we go think about them other kind of stuff. But for now, it's just the aim is repatriation.
Repatriation is mean everything to me. My whole life, to start my future plan on the other side of the sea and to build up my nation.
Yeah, getting back our gold, our diamond, especially our land, and for all what they do, our great grandparents saved them on this plantation. Our focus is to leave this plantation and go back where they had taken us from. Then we will think of the other things that used to come. There is a time that a lot of people will want to come and live like Rasta. When the cities fall down, when the earthquake, the tsunamis, and all them things happen, they want to be Rasta. So our advice to them is not to look at Rasta bad, because in the future to come, they will be the ones that have the dreadlocks.
Behold, bless ye Jah, Rastafari King Selassie I.
All ye servants. The lifestyle of the Rastafari complies with those that are currently prescribed by ecologists and environmentalists. The diet of the Rastas, which comprise of organic, vegetarian foods, has been a mainstay of the movement since its beginning. Yet, only recently has this idea gained traction in the Western world. The emphasis placed on small farms and sustainable agriculture has recently been recognized as a more viable form of sustenance. Because the Rasta did not allow himself to be separated from nature, he has become more aware of the laws which govern it, and therefore remain in deep respect for the earth, unlike the majority of the Western world. As for the use of the herb, the writing is already on the wall. Uncle Sam has sneezed, and it is just a matter of time until our small islands catch the decriminalization bug.
Jah anointed I net head with oil, I net cup runneth over.
Could go on, the fool has never been told. Could go on, the fool has never been told. Could go on, the fool has never been told. Could go on, the fool has never been told. Has never been told. Could go on and on. The fool has never been told. Could go on and on. The
fool has never been.